I'm Debbie Ryan.
I'm Jesse, and you're watching Disney Channel. For me.
When I was younger, one of my favorite traditions in shows was the body switching episode. For some reason, it's like required that every children's show has a body switching episode. I don't know why this is. So imagine my excitement when I see the Freaky Freakin' advertised on Disney Channel. For those who were not around in the April of 2013, the Freaky Freakin' was this weird thing on Disney Channel where all of the shows would have body switching episodes. It was always really exciting to see the commercial for this special because it looked really promising with all the characters freaking out and screaming. But that might have also been because most Disney Channel commercials were like for Best Western. Why were they advertising Best Western on Disney Channel? They think it would make kids want to stay in their hotels? I swear, those commercials and the Danimal sweepstake commercials came on so often that they're like burned into my brain permanently.
Like this, right? Smooth!
But we're gonna review all of the episodes of the Freaky Freakin' to see how they hold up all of these years later. Anyway, we're gonna start with Season 2, Episode 13 of Jesse. To Be or Not to Be Me. Jesse was a really weird show. The premise revolved around a nanny played by Debbie Ryan taking care of these four spoiled, awful children because their parents more or less abandoned them. Over the 98 episodes of this show, their mom is in like 7 episodes and their dad is in 4. And they mention that 3 out of the 4 kids are adopted, so that really begs the question of who keeps giving these people children? They're more or less raised by Jesse and Bertram, and the show revolved around them compensating for their parents' absence. Anyway, this episode revolves around Ravi, the kid from India, receiving a magic bell that made everyone switch bodies.
Ooh, it is an ancient ceremonial bell!
Oh, great. One more thing for me to dust.
And this is a Gajamukta, an elephant bird. It is a rare and mysterious object rumored to have magical powers.
This show was kind of racist. It's a weirdly common trope in body switching media to have the tool come from a cultural appropriation. Normally it's China, but for whatever reason they chose to go with India in this episode. I guess it was 2013 and you could kind of get away with anything at this point because Twitter culture wasn't like how it is now. Case in point, the characters of Zuri and Ravi are like the most flagrant stereotypes you could possibly think of. Zuri's entire character is her being all sassy and
nasty.
That's just cold.
And Ravi is nerdy and lacks social cues. And is basically just used as a thesaurus. This episode revolves around 3 different plots. Jesse trying to act in her play in Zuri's body, Emma doing her stupid show in Luke's body, and Bertram, the maid, and Ravi switching bodies. I say 3 subplots, but to be honest, it's only really 2 because the stuff with Bertram and Ravi isn't so little of it that it only really amounts to 1 thing near the end of the episode. So anyway, Ravi gets his magic bell and then goes on about it for a bit, and then he leaves it in the kitchen for some reason, and Zuri comes along and talks about Reba fever.
I've got Reba fever.
And then Jesse is like, you're supposed to be in bed, Zuri. And she's like, ha ha ha, make me. I don't really understand. I've never understood this. Because Zuri could have just gone and watched Reba and not told Jesse. But I guess they needed the episode to go on. So Jesse gets mad at Zuri and they have a kerfuffle. Then Zuri grabs the bell for like no reason. And then, oh no, they switch bodies.
What just happened?
Why am I so short?
And why do I feel like I'm falling forward?
Did we just switch bodies?
Mm-hmm. Also, it's funny because she just runs around the table and stops for no reason. Jesse doesn't even catch her. She just kind of stops running and then she's like, ah, you caught me. So they switch bodies and we're subjected to hearing Debbie Ryan's very racist urban impression.
Mm-hmm.
Zuri is really okay with switching bodies because she wants to watch Reba, and be an adult, but Jesse's like, oh no, how am I gonna do my play? That's Jesse's like whole deal in the episode. She's like practicing for a play because like a wannabe actor, because in addition to not paying attention to their children, the parents of the children do not pay Jesse and Bertram at all. They even like mention it in the episode.
You know, this is my first real acting job in New York, other than looking happy every time I open my paycheck.
Tell me about it. We both deserve Oscars for that.
So Jesse tries to like make everyone believe that she's trapped in Zuri's body, but nobody believes her. Not even Ravi for some reason, even though he was clearly aware that the bell was special in the beginning of the episode. He had like a whole speech about it.
Rumored to have magical powers.
Anyway, there's a bunch of nonsense for a bit, and then Luke and Emma get into a really contrived fight and switch bodies. Luke is like the typical Disney Channel like jock character. He's like, I don't like school, I like sports and stuff. Emma's like the Disney Channel like girly character. She's like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna wear pink and do fashion. And I'm realizing now that every character in this show is a stereotype of some sort. So they switch bodies and Emma's like,
what is that terrible smell? Ew, gross, it's me!
And then Luke is like,
dude, why are you wearing my face?
Low-key, I kind of wish this was the plot of the episode. Cameron Boyce and Peyton List just have much more chemistry with each other, and they do much better impressions of each other than Sky Jackson and Debbie Ryan. So we go back to the Zuri and Jesse plotline, and I forgot to mention this, but for whatever reason, Zuri dresses weirdly in Jesse's body. I think they're trying to say that she dresses like a little girl, but she never dressed weirdly before. So this would be a good time to mention that Zuri is extremely unlikable in this episode. I mean, all of the children in this show are fairly unlikable. Her actively refusing to help Jesse when she's the reason they're in this situation just makes her come across more as annoying. So the theater director comes up to Jesse and Zuri, and he says a bunch of silly stuff, and then Jesse is really worried because Zuri is refusing to cooperate. And if you notice, this plot is really mundane and boring, because literally every plot line in Jesse was incredibly mundane and boring. For a children's sitcom, they was surprisingly content with just doing the bare minimum. I think there was one episode where they like did improv. I don't mean like they improv the episode, I mean like the character Jesse just joined an improv group and that was the entirety of the episode. You would think that with like a crazy body switching plot line they might do something a little more exciting, but no. So we go back to Luke and Emma, and Emma is really concerned because she wants to have her Kitty Couture show. That was a stupid show that she had that I think was only in like 4 episodes. I don't know. But anyway, Luke is like, no, I don't want to do that. I'm a boy. And she bribes him with the power of the male gaze.
No way.
Really? Because I have 4 slumber party invitations for next weekend. If you help me, you can take your pick.
Ooh, deal! This is gonna be the greatest pillow fight of my life!
And so he does it, and he does a really poor job, and she's sad, and they have a heartfelt moment. But then it turns out that they actually like Luke.
OMG! This is fantabulous!
Please don't use my mouth to say that!
My viewers actually liked you! Look! Kitty gives us an insightful glimpse into the secret mind of boys!
Oh, who could have seen that coming? So anyway, we switch back to the Zuri and Jesse plotline, and Jesse is looking to Ravi for how to switch back, and turns out that it's not Ravi, it's actually Bertram.
I fear I have some demoralizing news.
Ooh! I don't really understand how this happened, especially because Ravi is like the nice one of the family, and he already knew about the dangers of the bell. So this makes absolutely no sense, and the creators of the show knew that it made no sense because they cut the scene that it was happened in. So we don't actually see how it happened, we just have to make it up in our imagination. This is really random, but I remember watching this scene on my iPad in like 5th grade and seeing a video called like, Does Jesse Curse? And it was this scene. And it was Jesse saying focus, but she says it in a funny way, so it sounds like she's cursing. I don't really know why I still remember that. So Jesse goes to her play and Zuri has to perform and it's a huge disaster. Oh no. But then, in the nick of time, Ravi figures out the solution. It turns out that when everyone was holding the bell, they were saying mean things to each other. So in order to switch back, you just have to say nice things to each other.
Each time the switch occurred, those who touched the bell were arguing. So if I am correct, these negative elements, when bombarded by positive energies, might switch us back.
Except nobody was fighting when they had the bell. Jesse was just telling Zuri to go to bed because she is her authority figure. And Emma was telling Luke to stop being mean to Ravi. And she was literally taking up for her brother.
Give him back his Sanjay Gupta!
So everybody switches back and Luke and Emma make this really creepy joke about going to the bathroom.
Just be glad we both switched back before one of us had to use the bathroom.
And then Jesse switches bodies with Mrs. Kibling, their lizard, but it doesn't matter because the whole thing was a dream by the lizard. And spoiler alert, a lot of the shows in this list use this method because for whatever reason they didn't want to break the groundedness of their shows. I don't really see why this mattered so much, but apparently it did. I feel like this episode was really damaged by splitting all the characters up. It would have been really funny to see them interact with each other and bounce off of each other, like as each other, but for some reason they just have these really dull subplots that are really not interesting outside of the body switching kerfuffle. I always wanted to see deleted scenes from this episode because I think that they would have been really interesting, but I can't find them anywhere and I don't think they exist because this is a mostly forgotten sitcom that aired a decade ago. Next! Okay, this is something I just found while editing this video, but there's like an Indian version of this show. I have no idea what they're saying, but it still has like the same vibe as the English version.
Wow, kya khushboo hai! Iska matlab Tony ne nahi banaya.
See, tum frog brain soup kyun pee rahi ho?
The second episode of this special was season 1, episode 12 of Dog with a Blog, titled Freaky Fido. This show is a gigantic meme to me. Why did someone decide to make a show called Dog with a Blog? And who produced it? Basically, the premise of this show is that Stan is a talking dog, and he has a blog about his life experiences. But he also doesn't want anyone to know that he talks, which has never made any sense to me. Like, he doesn't even try to hide the fact that he's a dog. He just posts about it on the internet. And they even mention this on the show's IMDb page. If anyone in the Dog with a Blog fandom has an explanation for this, feel free to reach out to me. But it doesn't even really matter, because half the time the dog and his blog didn't really even factor into the plot, and it was just an extremely milquetoast sitcom. For whatever reason, this was the most grounded of all the Disney Channel shows. Even though there's a talking dog, there's almost no other fantastical elements in any episodes that I can remember. It was mostly just centered around really tepid, bland family drama. Like, oh no, Avery had a falling out with her friend. Is she gonna make up with her? Remember there's one episode where the Avery gets an Instagram page and her parents act like she committed a crime?
Sunday, August 11th. Avery goes to an online site that's strictly off limits.
Why would you do this?
So this episode revolves around Avery being obsessed with making a film for her class and making that everyone's problem, but then she learns not to stress out and actually have fun. Yay. I'm so happy for her. I don't think there's anything else to say about this episode, or this entire show for that matter. It's so weird to me. This show just like exists in my memory as the blandest thing ever. It doesn't even feel like a real show. It feels like someone like replaced a memory. It feels like a fake show. I don't know how to explain it. Like you know in movies when they have like fake sitcoms like in the background, like this show is like a fake movie sitcom if it were just made unironically. Like look at these episode descriptions. It's like Avery makes the cheerleading squad. Tyler enters the same art competition as Avery. Avery has a crush on a boy who idolizes Tyler.
Yeah, I haven't seen that many A's in a row since Aardvark Auto opened that annex over on Avenue A.
Stan, you think I'm fun, right?
Avery, I think you're very, very smart.
Can I use your laptop to watch a video my friends made?
Yeah, whatever. No laughing, singing, or giggling. Why do people think I'm not fun?
Chloe! I'm sorry. This movie is hilarious. My friends are so fun.
That's it.
You're gonna hang around Chloe's friends and hope they make you fun?
So early, I haven't even had my first cup of cuppy. Did we have to be here at 6 a.m.?
It's actually 5. I reset the clocks to get a head start.
Daddy's head still hasn't started.
Oh, here I am!
Call it Freaky Fido, marking his territory at a theater near you.
I like it. But is anybody gonna believe a talking dog?
I could freak you out so bad right now.
I have more depth and dignity than anyone gives me credit for.
You have a love scene with Nikki.
Let's shoot this movie!
Why did I agree to do this? I hate acting, I hate it!
You really don't have to do this if you
I was only acting that I hate acting.
Maybe a little mouth-to-mouth will shake a few memories loose.
What are you doing?
Mommy's got something in her nose and I was just trying to see it. George, as in Clooney.
As in curious.
I can eat fast, but it gives me the hookups.
You mean hiccups?
No, hookups. I go, hook?
First, you guys tell me that I don't know how to have fun, and now you're telling me that I don't know how to make a movie?
No, we're not telling you any of that.
Now you're telling me you're not telling me any of that?
That is offensive on so many levels.
Are you kidding me? They're the ones who aren't listening to everything I say and doing everything exactly how I want it. And no matter how many times I scream at them, oh my gosh, I am the problem.
It is so sad what happened. I cannot imagine how frightened and confused he must be.
Nikki, it's okay. It's just a movie.
Shh, I'm acting.
She's good. Can you guys just give us a moment?
Okay, but I wasn't rolling. We're gonna have to do that again.
The next episode is Season 2, Episode 20 of Ant Farm. Identity Crisis. I don't know how to say that. This episode begins in media res with China, the main character, having a seizure and explaining dramatically while she's being chased by her classmates who are walking very slowly.
Who I was. I thought I knew who my friends were. But today was not like any other day. Nothing was like it normally is. Except for the main title sequence.
I forgot how good the theme song for this show was. We then flash back earlier in the episode and we see China's friends, Oliver and Fletcher, come in and talk about how their principal has sold the rights of everything in the school for money, and Fletcher is wearing a costume because he's the silly one. Olive and Fletcher were like the wacky best friends of China. Basically, Olive has a photographic memory but no social cues, and Fletcher is good at art but completely incompetent at everything else. The trio then talk about how much they hate their principal, and they do the classic, "She's right behind me, isn't she?"
That sounds nothing like Skidmore. It's more like, back in my day, we respected our elders because there were only two of them. Come on, that sounded just like Skidmore. And I even had her dead look in my eyes.
Principal Skidmore's character is that she's mean and stuck up and always ruining the fun. It is the exact same character and actor as the one from iCarly, and this has always bothered me. Skidmore then talks about a frozen yogurt machine, and she lets a secret loose about her plot to destroy the kids.
Ooh.
Then the character Violet comes in and she starts talking like a zombie.
Ooh.
Skidmore is wonderful. Enjoy some free yogurt.
Isn't she delightful?
Quick tangent, I never have understood Violet's role in this show. The plot of this show, if you don't know, is that they're like all child prodigies, And Violet's whole deal is that she's really abnormally strong, but how does that make her a prodigy? Like, lots of kids are athletic and strong, but that doesn't make you, like, a prodigy. This kind of brings up the elephant in the room with this show, in that the entire concept of the show makes absolutely no sense. Like, they're put in a high school because they're gifted, but none of their gifts are academic related. China is musically gifted, and Fletcher is a talented artist, but aside from that, they are completely normal children. Why are they qualified to go to a high school? The only one with exceptional intelligence is Olive. The rest of them just have like a cool skill on them. Anyway, Violet says creepy stuff in a monotone voice, and then Skidmore maniacally laughs, and we transition to Lexi. Lexi's character was that she was the mean rich girl of the show, and she was always bullying the ants for being children in high school. This show acts like that's a really unreasonable opinion to have, but is it? High schoolers are like inherently judgmental, and middle schoolers are inherently cringy, and having them in the same building for hours a day would be literal hell on earth. But anyway, no one cares about that because they just need Lexi to be the mean girl. Anyway, Lexi talks about her outfit to nobody, and then we see China's one-dimensional brother whose name escapes me. And they have a weird love scene, but it's actually a dream. But this plot is entirely irrelevant, so I'm gonna stop talking about it. We then see Principal Skidmore using a yogurt machine to extract Fletcher's personality. Apparently, she's been using this as a way to make an entire child army. Love how confused all of these kids look. When their personalities are extracted, they turn into these weird zombie things. And then China has to eat all the frozen yogurt and all the ants go inside her mind. This is actually a really fun and creative direction. And then China is captured because the ants inside her head try to control her too much, and she finds out more about Skidmore's plan.
Firstly, extract all the ants' personalities, including yours, from your brain. And then, when I eat all that yogurt, I will be a superwoman with all of your talents and my good looks.
But before Skidmore can enact her plan, she gets a call on her phone and is distracted. It's okay, because they make a joke about it beforehand.
Unlike movie villains who leave before seeing their plan through to completion, thus enabling the hero to escape, I am going to throw the switch myself! I have to take that.
So they extract all the personalities into yogurt, but uh-oh, they all eat the wrong ones. And now everybody's mixed up. Oh no.
Leave him trapped inside Olive. Oh, her brain is interesting factoids, sticky notes everywhere.
This type of thing is kind of cliche, but I honestly don't mind it because it's fun and silly. And when you watch the, like, Jesse episode and how, like, dull it is, it's so refreshing to see, like, actual creativity used in an episode like this. The only complaint I have is that they do this stupid voiceover thing where the characters, like, have each other's voices.
And you better take care of my body. Just like I plan on taking care of this adorable body.
I never understand why movies and TV shows do that. It's inherently more fun to have actors do impressions of each other. The whole voiceover thing just makes it weird. Before they can all switch back, Skidmore returns and threatens to kill everyone, but she gets distracted again and they extract her personality. But she doesn't have a personality, so she gets like nothing. I actually thought that was pretty funny. But it turns out the whole thing was just a story by China, but then it's actually not a story by China. And it doesn't matter because this whole show was more or less nonsense, and I greatly appreciate that. Half of the episodes of this show are completely incomprehensible, but it doesn't even matter because who needs sense or logic in a Disney Channel sitcom? I know I don't. But yeah, this episode was actually way more funny and creative than I remembered, especially compared to Dog with a Blog and Jesse. Moving on. The next episode is Season 3, Episode 14 of Shake It Up, Switch It Up. This show was about two girls who went on a dance show and, did things. I don't know. There wasn't really much of a plot. They just kind of danced. Despite having Zendaya on this show, I never really hear anyone talk about this show. Probably because it was kind of boring. Even as a young child, it was painfully obvious this show was primarily marketed towards the girl market. It's like the inverse of Lab Rats in that way. But in this episode, the main character Cece switches bodies with her brother Flynn because they get into the most basic sibling argument ever.
Okay, you think it's easy to be me?
And you think it's easy to be
and her friend Tinka accidentally puts a magical spell on them to the power of ignorance.
You know, when we were young and my brother and I used to fight like this, my grandmama would always say, prosciutto, buy knife, flip and flop.
Tinka's, like, entire character was that she was the snobby exchange student who slowly becomes friends with the main characters. Basically, Petra from Jane the Virgin, which I believe came on after this show, so maybe they stole it from Shake It Up, who knows. Anyway, this episode is pretty by the numbers. There's not really much to say. Flynn and Cece learn to appreciate each other, but they actually learn nothing because the entire episode is a dream by Cece in the end. The only thing of note here is that there's a subplot where Zendaya's character, Rocky, tries to murder her brother for something he did to her. I've never understood why they needed to put this plot in here. It amounts to nothing. And because the whole thing is in Cece's mind, it implies that Cece is kind of racist because the spell that Tinka uses is like gobbledygook German nonsense.
Prosciutto, buy knife, flip and flop.
That is offensive on so many levels.
Also, there's one joke where Flynn talks about having to get dressed in the dark to avoid seeing his sister naked.
Change, you look like you got dressed in the dark.
Probably because I did. There are still some things that should remain a mystery.
Why did Disney Channel writers feel the need to put these types of jokes in children's shows? I don't understand this. Was this episode written by Dan Schneider? Next, we have Season 2, Episode 12 of Austin and Ally, Freaky Fans and Fan Fiction. We open with Austin and friends at Trish's new job. That was the Trish's gag. She had a new job in every episode. Dez, the wacky ginger guy, requests a typewriter because he's in a short story contest. He is competing against his rival, Chuck.
My story's so short, you could see its feet on its driver's license. My story's so short, it's not allowed to go on any carnival rides. My story's so short, when it sits on a dime, its feet don't touch the ground. My story's so short I think I smell smoke. Must be your brain on overdrive.
When Dez finally does find a typewriter, he finds out that it's a magical typewriter, and anything he types comes to fruition.
Giant man-eating fish slowly approached.
Ally and Trish are skeptical of this at first, but after a few tries, they become convinced of it as well. This is very random, but I saw this thing on Twitter where someone said that they think Ally would be homophobic in real life, and I can't stop thinking about it every time she talks. The actor that plays her saw it too, apparently. So once everyone is convinced of the typewriter's magic, Dez starts granting all of his friends' wishes. Austin gets a cheerleader and the dunking ability. Ally gets books because she's nerdy. Trish gets money because she hates working. It's really funny how Trish embodies the Gen Z work ethic like 5 years before Gen Z entered the job market. But then disaster strikes when Chuck steals the typewriter and calamity ensues. He makes all their hair turn purple, and then he gives Dez weird noodle fingers, and then he makes him switch bodies.
Whoa, I feel weird. What just happened?
You're always weird, you doof. What else is new?
They do the stupid voice switching thing again, and I just don't understand. It would be less work and much funnier for them to just do their normal voices. I know nobody else cares about that but me. Also, for some reason, Austin and Ally don't switch bodies. Maybe it's just me, but I would think that the first thing you would think of, since Austin is outgoing and cool, and Ally is more introverted and shy, but maybe they just didn't want to be predictable. Chuck says that in order to stop messing with the group, Dez needs to apologize for stealing his look.
Cowboy wasn't my first choice. Wacky pants and silly shirts used to be my thing. See?
But Dez, overtaken by his pride, refuses to. So he makes Trish and Ally like super down bad for him.
You're so cute. Kittens look at pictures of you on the internet.
You're so cute. Instead of calling babies cutie pies, they call them Chucky pies.
Back off, Ally.
He's mine.
No, he's mine.
Ladies, ladies, there's enough Chucky pie to go around. Everyone gets a slice.
And then he turns Ally into Abraham Lincoln and he gives Austin hooves so he'll fail his driver's test. But then all of the plot lines converge into one when Austin crashes his driving test car into their music store.
Everybody run!
Oh, I guess it is kind of hard to drive with hooves.
Considering that their music store is located in like a mall plaza, it implies that Austin has like committed mass vehicular manslaughter. They don't disclose how far away the DMV is away from the store, so it could potentially be a lot of people. But it doesn't even matter, because once again, the entire thing was just made up by Dez. Turns out that the whole episode was the story that he was writing for the short story contest. At the very least, it is clever and makes sense. This was never the best Disney Channel show, but it also wasn't the worst. I would say it's somewhat like mid-tier. Like, not bad, but not great either. Next. Also, I found this really funny IMDb review for this episode. So I thought this episode was weird, yet very interesting. The minute I found out about the magic typewriter, I wanted one so bad, because it was sure as heck make my life better, and I would use it pretty much every second of every day. All the stuff that happened was so cool, especially when the hot dogs fell from the sky. The body switching was so interesting, and I would love to switch bodies with someone. It would be really cool, my oh my. I know it's all a short story or whatever, but it was one cool story. I don't know about you, but this was a great episode, and certainly one of my favorites. I just loved it. It was funny, interesting, and pretty cool. Next, we have Season 1, Episode 16 of Gravity Falls, Carpe Diem. Gravity Falls was the most horrifying and inappropriate show that ever could have come on Disney Channel, and it was a massive success with children everywhere. This episode in particular has a ton of moments that I'm surprised got past the censors. So, twins Dipper and Mabel live with their grunkle, and they decide that they're growing apart and want to move rooms. So their grunkle Stan uses this as an opportunity to exploit the children, saying, "Whoever does the most for him will earn the room." So Dipper and Mabel get into a kerfuffle where they're each trying to outwit each other to get the room, and this leads to them finding a magic carpet that switches their bodies through the magic of nonsense science.
Carpet. Atoms can swap electrons. This carpet must build up a static charge so powerful it can swap minds. It was the static electricity!
Yes, science!
When they do switch bodies, we actually get a really haunting montage of what a sibling body swap would realistically look like. Although I do have to take off points for doing the whole voice swapping thing. You would think Gravity Falls, of all shows, would be above doing this, but apparently not. From this point on, the episode is just hijinks of Dipper and Mabel doing wacky things and sabotaging each other.
Stan! I've always hated you! Haha, see who he gives the room to now!
In the B-plot, the handyman Seuss switches bodies with a pig, but that's mostly just nonsense. I like how they could easily just switch back the entire episode, but instead they just choose to ruin each other's lives. It feels very much like what a real sibling would do. But then, in the end, Dipper and Mabel learn to see past their differences, and we get a wacky body-swapping montage with the entire town for some reason, and then they switch back, and all is well. There's not really a lot I can say on this show because it's mostly just a really solid, well-written show, and there's not really even a lot to make fun of. Moving on, the last episode is Season 4, Episode 10 of Phineas and Ferb, Mindshare. Phineas and Ferb needs no introduction. It is an iconic classic and one of the best shows to ever come from the Disney Channel, period. This actually wasn't the first body-switching episode of Phineas and Ferb. That was actually Season 1's Does This Duck Bill Make Me Look Fat? In which Candace and Perry switch bodies. That episode premiered in the Seriously Switched Up Sunday of special, which was basically just the Freaky Freakend, but 5 years earlier. I should have played outside more as a child. This episode has Phineas and cohorts switching bodies with a bunch of aliens, but it turns out they're all criminal aliens, and so now the gang is stuck in alien prison, and it turns into a parody of The Shawshank Redemption. Something I'm sure that every kid in 2013 understood. The thing about Phineas and Ferb is that after a certain point, Phineas and Ferb became the least interesting part of the show, and it more or less became about Doofenshmirtz. Doofenshmirtz in this plot is taking up square dancing to impress a woman he met online. I could have sworn that this is the same episode where he takes up country western, but I guess that's a different one. To be honest, a lot of the later episodes of Phineas and Ferb blur together. It's the problem when you have a show that uses the exact same formula that goes on for like 8 years. This episode is really short and there's not really a lot to say about it. Candace uses square dancing to save Phineas and Ferb in the end. Doofenshmirtz loses his girlfriend because he is not allowed to be happy. I admit it, another hole got me finished. Broke my heart, oh no you didn't. Fuck sipping, I'ma down a whole bottle. Hard liquor, hard truth can't swallow. As Phineas and Ferb episodes go, I don't think this is one of the best or most memorable ones, but it was also towards the end of the series when I think they were starting to run out of ideas. Still better than the dog with a blog episode though. Amazing. This was one of the better episodes of Phineas and Ferb because it showed that Phineas and Ferb can get in turmoil too. Probably the scariest episode of Phineas and Ferb. Okay, let me begin. For kids, this is an adventure story about justice and getting your body back, as well as to be careful of strangers or things that seem too good to be true. For adults, it's another story completely. The entire prison story is taken from The Shawshank Redemption, quote Stephen King, which includes violence, swearing, and this is a kid's show. Now, not that I'm against jokes that only adults get or criticizing writers, but it's just so creepy. The suggestion when Buford is in a fly's body, but there are lizards is just so unnerving. I don't know what's worse. The implication a parent will get because Buford being another species or a child. The implication of what would happen if the gang failed are too much to think about. This is probably the only episode where the gang's story is more aggressive than Perry's story. So I give this a 7 and say that this is a lot like Coraline. A children's story which scares adults more. That's it. That's all the episodes that premiered for Freaky Freakend. There was another Wizards of Waverly Place special that premiered as well, but I think that deserves a video of its own. Like I said earlier, there are lots of body swap episodes of kids shows, so comment below if you want me to review more. For now, make sure to like, subscribe, comment below, follow my Instagram.